Well, I think that any church that is seeking to show and share the love of Christ by identifying themselves as believers and living sent in their community is seeking to be missional. People often ask me, you know, what's an example of a missional church? List to me the missional churches.
They want the criteria so they know if they need it or not.
Exactly. And I don't know that it's a checklist, and I don't know that we should treat it as a checklist. I think we need to recognize that this is something we're all seeking to live. We're seeking to live on mission, and there are challenges with that. And so some of the things that you described, ministering to the widow, to the elderly, as you mentioned it, ministering to the sick, I think those are the kind of things that Christians living on mission do. So I would certainly say that's missional activity. That's working for the kingdom and for the agenda of God. I would say that teaching people the Bible are those things. I think part of the challenge is those activities become the exception rather than the norm. I think a church that's going to be missional is not going to have a few superstars who are engaging in those kinds of ministries, but they're going to, as a body, each one having received a special gift, they're going to use it to serve one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. That's what I've been talking about here at the Evangelical Presbyterian Church General Assembly. We've been talking about, just moments ago, each one using their gifts. And I think for me, the issue is not that there are believers living on mission. I think most churches that love the Word and love the Lord, they're going to have some people living on mission. My desire is for us to see a greater number of people participating in the mission of God, moving from sitting in rows to sitting in circles, provoking one another to love and good deeds, and living on mission. That, to me, I think, is the next step. The missional church is moving beyond ideas that pastors talk about at pastors' conferences and actually seeing people live on mission. Well, I think a church with some missional activity is a good first step, but as you said, it's not the final end game. I think what you do is you find those who want to live on mission. Pastors would then equip, train, Ephesians 4 kind of stuff, where they're, pastors and teachers equipping God's people for works of ministry to the building up of the body of Christ. But I think then you've got to hold up what that looks like. I'm a firm believer as a church, as a denomination, what you celebrate, you become.
Okay.
So I believe that if you communicate to the church as a whole and say, listen, here's something that's going on right now. I'll give you an example. You were a brand new church, 8 weeks old at the time of this taping. But one of the things we're doing is our life groups, we call them. Last week, one of them went and ministered to the homeless under the bridge. We did some things in our community a week before that. Well, we do those things, but then also we communicate that we're doing those things to the congregation. So we invite them to participate. We celebrate it. So the goal is not attendance. The goal is missional activity. And so by changing that scorecard or perception, by celebrating it, we believe we become it more likely. So I think churches can take outposts of missional activity and work towards being a more intentionally missional church by making the exception the norm and communicating it that way. I think celebration is a key to participation. If you want people to participate, they need to see that you value something. It's obvious that we value attendance and giving. So, because we talk about it all the time, tell people they should come and they should give. We have campaigns about attendance and giving. What I would say is that, again, what you celebrate, you become. If you celebrate attendance and giving, you end up with a church full of people who give and show up. Great. But I think when you celebrate mission activity, people, let's say global involvement. The first non-Sunday morning gathering of our church. We had a dinner a few weeks ago. We passed out passport applications. And people are like, why are you passing out passport applications? Well, because we're going to be a global church from the beginning. We're going to adopt an unreached people group. We're zeroing in on which one. And so we want all of you to have passports because it's part of it. Well, right at the beginning, we're celebrating the global nature of God's global mission. So that becomes an important part of it. But then we tell stories about it. We share about it. I got back from Central Asia. We shared what we saw. I've used it in my messages several times. But when we begin to deploy teams, we'll have them come back and to share so that others will be involved. And it really creates a sense of positive, is peer pressure the right word? I don't know. I don't know that it is. But a positive esprit de corps, a desire to be a part of something greater than ourselves. That's what we want to hold up. I don't know about you, but I don't know many people who are real satisfied with church as a consumer activity. And I think they want something more. And I think when you show them lives changed by the power of the gospel, people living on mission, people making a difference, that's a compelling vision people will follow. Ephesians 3:10 says God has chosen the church to make known his manifold wisdom. And I think as believers and as a gathered church, we're to engage in the mission of God different ways, but consistently so that the mission of God really just flows forth from our lives as we join him faithfully. So Luke 4 speaks of serving. Luke 19:10 speaks of saving. So I believe we join Jesus in his mission of serving a hurting world. It's a broken and hurting world. Serving a hurting world and saving, bringing his message of saving that world as well. So serving and saving give us a good picture of what it means to live on mission with Jesus.